Welcome to my presentation. I'm absolutely thrilled to see that I have neighbors that are here. I have former students that are here. They're still talking to me, so this is a wonderful thing. And I have family that's here as well, and just townspeople around. I really appreciate that you took the time to come out and see this presentation, okay, on music and healing. Tonight, we're going to discuss two basic forms of music, both born from the Catholic Church, and that is the chants and also motets. I want to be clear that I'm not here teaching religion, but it's hard to ignore those beautiful texts that go along with all this great music. And quite frankly, that is the roots of choral singing come from the Renaissance period and the Catholic Church, and we don't want to ignore that history. So I hope you enjoy what I have to share. I can lay everything out for you. We're going to have kind of a little discussion of how these pieces, they do seem formless, but there is form in them that will help you understand the music a whole lot better, I feel. And then we're going to do a lot of listening, and I hope you experience healing through listening. I have a setup with quadraphonic sound, so I don't have to play anything loudly. Except for maybe a couple of them, and then you're going to enjoy this. I hope you will enjoy this, is what I'm trying to say. Now, I need to get your feedback, okay? So we're here and we're discussing healing and how music makes you feel. How does this first excerpt make you feel? To keep along the subject matter, I chose this excerpt called Painkiller by Judas Priest. I thought that would fit into the rest of the presentation. How does that make you feel? Ready to lay down and go to sleep and relax and have it healed all of your problems mentally?
Yes.
Honestly, how does it make you feel? Somebody say something. I'll pick on you because I know I can. Oh, yes.
Killing me.
It's killing you? Yes. I agree with you 100%. Not my style, but I guess I can appreciate that others like it. Okay?
Gets my heart rate up. This is like
workout. Get your heart rate up. Oh boy, we're going to have some down heart rate music. In fact, if I do my job right, this may be the most boring lecture I've ever done in my life. Okay, and I get to try it out on you guys. How else does this make you feel? Yes, sir.
I've learned that you can't appreciate calm without first learning what chaos is.
I think that's a great juxtaposition of those two feelings. Beautiful. Yes. Like happiness and sadness, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else have something? Yes, sir.
Nostalgic. Makes me feel energetic. Makes me feel happy. And but in a different kind of way than Renaissance motets would. It's sort of energetic, party-ish, sort of dance-like.
That's right, absolutely. Thank you, Western students, for speaking out. That was very nice. Keeps the action going and everything. I appreciate that. I'll pay you later, by the way. Okay, here we go. Healing a non-medical, I love this definition. I looked everywhere when you talk about healing, it always infers medicine. This does not. So what we're trying to do is return to a natural state of well-being. And I love Olivia's definition here because unlike medicine, it's not linear. Okay, so you have to constantly be working on this to achieve the satisfactory results and to rest and to feel relaxed. Okay, now, music is a source of healing throughout history. We've come all the way from antiquity to no science, but you know, we still tried to use it. Then we go into the late 19th century, early 20th century, and we have some soft science. And then now we're in a wonderful time of actual brain science, and I have something important at the end of the presentation to share with you that I think you're going to like. Okay? Let's do a very simplified walkthrough of how music affects your brain. What is the process? Okay? Well, first of all, we hear vibrations. I believe the quality of those vibrations will include the quality or will help the quality of your listening experience. Okay? Secondly, the inner ear takes these vibrations and converts them to electrical signals. The neurons transfer it to the cerebral cortex, and then we have dedicated regions in the brain that will help decipher these electrical signals. Tone, pitch, and rhythm are located in different parts of the brain. And what I love is that we have a gestalt process that puts everything together and you have a musical experience. And this musical experience can influence our emotions and especially our bodily systems, which we'll look at a little bit later. Let's talk about the research. I'm not going to talk a lot about it, but I'm just going to show you all the findings and all the times that I've tried to find what really happens when we listen to music. And if you'll just read these as they're shown, that's all we're going to do. I outlined the last one in red because that's very important, and I have experienced that with my own mom. How can she not speak to me, and yet we have music therapists come in and they start singing songs from when she was a young girl or from her days in the church, and she could sing these hymns and didn't miss a beat. And I sat there with my jaw on the ground like, where did that come from? Well, as it turns out, what I love is the fact that these connections that are built with music in your brain when it comes to Alzheimer's and other things that decay at the brain function, it's the last to break down if they do at all. So that's a good thing to keep in mind as we continue to develop more connections in our brain by listening to great music. Okay? Let's go on. In actual clinical settings, this is what was discovered. Some of you have already enumerated these when listening to my first favorite piece of music. This one is in red because I found this very enlightening. You realize basically what we're saying is if you want music to have a greater impact on you, you know there's a stressful event coming. It works a lot better and is more effective if you listen to that music before you experience some sort of a negative, some sort of anxiety, some sort of not good. Okay? It works out beautifully that way. That does not mean that listening to music after a bad day has no effect, but lots of research studies have shown that listening beforehand, planning it beforehand, has a greater impact. I find that incredible information. The overall benefits that we've kind of discussed, but we'll go through quickly. These things look like good things we want. I found this also very interesting. By listening to music and the right kind of music, for this, you can actually develop a sense of community when you begin building these relationships with the type of music that you listen to. I think that's actually fascinating. So you don't have to feel alone listening to this by yourself. Just to be clear, it's not, won't heal everything, but it sure will make a lot of things better, Okay? Here's the whole point. What I love about this Renaissance music is the fact that something very, very old, over 500 years old, can make us feel new in our present 21st century. I love that. It shows to the greatness of this music. And as I mentioned earlier, composers today emulate the motet style for their composition. You find many, both sacred and secular motets, written today in this century, and it's based on that sound model. And I think that's absolutely magnificent, and I love that. Okay? So now you're going to want to know. And by the way, don't worry, the talking will stop soon. We'll get to listening pretty soon. So, why are Renaissance chants and motets so healing? What is it about the music that lends themselves to healing over maybe many other forms of music? Well, first of all, think about this. Listening to a motet or listening to a chant is a unique experience. We don't get up every day and listen to this music. Right? You don't have a chance to do that. It's not the first thing you think about when you're going to listen to music, right? What I love about that is the fact that you're listening with a pure mind. So we're bombarded all day long with commercial music, with other types of music that are designed to make you remember it, short little clips. Not so in these two styles of music, okay? So, there's a purity and relaxation feeling from this unique listening experience. Keep in mind that these two forms were composed, they were written for the specific fact to create a sense of mysticism and awe. Imagine living in the Renaissance and you spent all day out in the potato fields and then you went to church on Sunday and heard some of this glorious music. It had a profound influence on how you felt and how you thought and on your spirituality. It creates ethereal sounds, and that also comes, which I've tried to do today, make it feel like it's in a resonant cathedral where these would be heard. It's primarily vocal, okay? And I just want to get my little dig in here. A cappella does not, we think of a cappella singing just means voice only, but the term a cappella, which came from the Renaissance, actually means in the style of the chapel. So whatever noble person was in charge would decide how motets were going to be sung or played if they deemed it necessary, because that's what the royalty would like to do. So I want you to let them know that. Primarily, they were unaccompanied is the term I like to use. They're all done by the human voice, and at the time of the Renaissance, especially in the church, usually male singers sang it, unless you live somewhere out where there weren't a lot of resources and they allowed females to sing these parts. Oh, perish the thought. I do have several examples of where you'll hear some females singing both the chants and also some of the motets that we're doing. Here's what's important. The texts are obviously in Latin. You don't really need to know what the words are about, but what you need to enjoy are those pure Latin vowels. They're the primary vowels. If a choir sings something in tune, it's great. It sounds good. But when you take in tune singing with these beautiful, well-shaped primary vowel sounds, it excites the overtone series, which of course makes the vibrations so much more, and you take them in and it has even more healing effect. There's one group that does this exceptionally well that you'll hear an example come from. All right? Going on, the construct. These pieces, there are no bar lines or regularly occurring beats, okay? So what's important is the text and the meter of the text, which is usually grouped into twos and grouped into threes. So you'll hear that in some of our examples of the way things are put together. We don't have, you know, regularly occurring beats like one, two, three, four, or one, two, three, one, two, three. That wasn't a concept in the Renaissance. The music notation was not that. That didn't happen until the Baroque period, when instrumental became more important than vocal, and dance rhythms became ultimately more important. And since they were regularly occurring beats, we could start using bar lines and have meter signatures and everything. It changed a lot. Next, sections connect seamlessly. So you have a phrase that goes, and as it starts to die away, another phrase takes over, and this is a concept called elision. It keeps the music flowing beautifully, seamlessly. There are no dynamic markings. How cool is that? Did that mean that they had no idea of loud and soft? They did. But imagine this music sung in a cathedral and it echoes so much. How do you sing louder? How do you sing softer? Because it all kind of sounds the same. Well, you do that by the number of singers you have on each part. If you want a piece to get louder, well, we'll just throw in some extra singers here, and then it will sound acoustically louder. You know, if you ever go to a church that's really live, and you'll notice it's hard to change the dynamic levels with all the reverberation. All right? Melodies, what can you expect? And I can't wait for you to see the next slide coming up in a little bit. The narrow range. Melodies are usually within an octave. They are primarily stepwise, or conjunct, as we like to call it. So the melodies don't jump around a whole lot. They're very smooth. They're very rounded. They're very soothing. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, the music is always flowing. Did I go the wrong way? Here we go. All right, harmony, beautiful, resonant, tertian harmony. Here's what's cool. The way we get harmony, the composers didn't sit down and write a chord and write out another chord. They did melodies that stacked on top of each other, and when you align all those melodies, all happening at a different time, the resultant sound was harmony. You heard the harmony. So you could hear the melody. You could, if you spoke Latin, you can understand the text, and it sounds absolutely beautiful. Such a simple way, but yet it really is highly complex. You will hear, and by the way, I should address this, resonant tertian harmony. So the interval of a fifth was very important, especially to medieval and to early Renaissance. So when we, if they listen to our music today where we hear a chord, you know, like C, E, G, well, they would think that sounds horrible, especially early Renaissance. But as the Renaissance developed, then we began listening for the tertian harmony, which means it has three notes in there, which we do, filled with beautiful suspensions and resolutions that you will hear in our examples. Here's something, too, I think you might find that makes this really mystical, is the fact that they don't use major minor scales like we understand today. They used modal scales, so they were not in a key, they were in a mode based on the seven church modes, all based on a different time, okay? Here shows you seven, there are many more, but these are the main seven church modes. So a composer, when he had a certain text that he wanted to reflect a certain way, he chose a mode that brought out the sound that he would like to have to sing that. Isn't that interesting? So, Ionian is just like our major scale. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do. Nice scale, we know that. But what if you're gonna sing in Dorian? It sounds like re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, re. So we have now a minor scale, but you know, the half steps and whole steps are in weird places from what we're used to in the 20th and 21st centuries, okay? I won't promise you I'm not gonna sing through all of them, but this is kind of our harmonic basis for what we're going to be listening to. Now, are you ready? Let's look at some real music, okay? This is a piece of Gregorian chant. It's almost the right size that it would look like if it was in a part book. So you can go to some of these churches and they had big altar levels where they had the part books up there. They were huge, and people walked up, the choir members, to sing these, and they read this. Notice this music is a lot different than our music, okay? So what I'd like for you to really understand is that you have to appreciate all of our modern composers that know this notation well enough to transfer it into our modern notation. That is quite a skill. And you're in the music publishing business, you know how hard that is, okay? So let me point out some things. This is so beautiful. All done by hand. Probably takes about a month. That's considered a short amount of time in the Renaissance to get a piece of music completed, okay? This is called an illumination. These colors, in fact, show you what the piece is, the spirit of the piece. So the singers look at that and kind of know the spirit in which they need to sing this. Also, it highlights the first ultum text here, and you can see it, every piece always starts this way with the illumination and the enlarged first letter. Additionally, you see we don't have the regular kind of notes. These are called neumes. And if I took it another level, we could call that black mensural notation. So these neumes help the singers kind of know generally how fast or slow. They all kind of work it out themselves, you understand? These aren't like a quarter note gets one beat like we think about today in modern notation. So I love the way this is all done. Have you noticed they only have four lines and we have five in our modern? I think that's absolutely wonderful. And just show you something that you may not notice. Do you see these little funny looking things at the end of every line? Because these pages were so large, it was hard for a singer to finish up here and then find their place on the other side of the music. So we had these little things called custos, which allowed us to know what note was there, so they wouldn't interrupt the flow of the piece. They could get ahead on the note that was coming next to it. And this little thing is kind of like our version of a treble clef, okay? And we knew where the tonic or the first note of the scale always was, all right? So I think that's very good. This little thing right here is called a ligature, which kind of lets them know to make the note last longer as they go on to the next section of the melody. All right? Now, enough talking. Let's do some listening. Here's a chant. Sicut cervus. As the heart longs for the water springs, so longs my soul for you, O God. This chant is from the Liber Usualis. It's a 60-minute clip I have for the first part of this chant. I hope you enjoy it. I also ask, at any time you listen to these examples, you don't have to watch the screen. I just thought it would be more interesting to see action on the screen. If you want to shut your eyes and listen, then I invite you to do that as well. Did you guys kind of hear that combination of two and three groupings that go in there? Okay, I love this. One of my favorite chants. Now, just so you kind of know, this isn't it sounds happenstance, but it is not. Okay? They have a concept which we use today called text painting. The music reflects what the text means. In this case, it shows what is important. So, here is the English translation. You can tell the water brooks, or in Latin, aquarum, is very important. Why? Look at all those notes. This concept is called melismata. You want to make it important? Give it a lot of notes. hey, you want to make it even more important? Then let's pitch those notes really high, and you'll notice that these notes are about the highest notes there are. So this is the real focal point of this particular chant. Also notice another very important word is God, O God, or Deus is in the Latin. And look at all of these notes that stay high for a long time and then gently fall back to the first note of the scale, of the modal scale. Really shows a lot of importance there. So it may sound happenstance in your listening experience, but these are highly crafted pieces of vocal music. All right? Now let's quickly go through the motet, and then we're going to have some fun. The motet is a short polyphonic, that sounds like a dirty word, doesn't it? A short polyphonic musical setting for chorus. Sometimes it can be homophonic. Polyphonic means many sounds. How technical is that, right? But we, you know, in choir world, we have to have words so we think we're smart, right? Polyphonic, many, many sounds. In this case, it would be many melody, the same melody happening several times to create the harmony. You will hear many examples of us breaking that rule and to be homophonic, which is basically a chordal texture that we would be very at home with, like hearing a hymn at church or something like that, okay? Now, again, they're in Latin, and they often use chants as the melody. So melodies, and the term for that is cantus prius factus, which means pre-existing melodies that they brought in. And by the way, they didn't have to be chants. Sometimes they were secular stuff. You might hear it on the corner someday, some lute playing something, and then they would hear that and put it into a motet. It's absolutely wonderful, all right? Are you ready? Let's learn the basic construct of a motet. Okay? Let's see. Let's all sing Row, Row, Row Your Boat together. I'll keep it low. I'm a tenor. I pitched too high. I'm sorry. Row, row, row your boat. Yeah, that's good. Is that right, dear? Smart? Mm-hmm. Okay, here we go. Ready? From the beginning. Everyone, can you sing with me? Check your body position, please. I'm just kidding. Oh, they did it. Little sure. Okay. Hey, I haven't lost it. Okay, here we go. Ready? Two, ready, go. Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 merrily.
Life is but a dream.
My gosh, I'm going to take you home with me and we're going to rehearse more tonight. Way to go. Let's do it again. Are you ready? Now sing twice as loud. Two, ready, go.
Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream.
Well, since we have a lot of singers in the crowd, let's divide into parts. Ready? You be part one. Will, from you over, part one. Part two, right here, all the way to right here. And part three will be everybody else over here. Start singing when I cue you. You ready? One, two, ready, go.
Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream.
Row your boat gently down the stream.
Row your boat gently down the stream.
Merrily, merrily,
merrily, merrily, merrily, life is down the stream.
Merrily, 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 merrily,
life is down the stream.
Did you notice we made some pretty good harmony? And all we did was sing one vocal line. Well, that is the basic premise of a polyphonic motet. You have a melody. The composer is so skilled, they create these magnificent harmonies. I love that. Let's change the harmony. Let's change the piece and make it a different texture. Get ready. I'm going to cue you real fast. Would you start us off again? Ready? Two, three, go.
Row, row, row your boat.
Hear it?
Merrily, 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 life is but a dream.
Loud. Did you notice we changed the texture? Did you notice we changed the internal rhythm by having people overlap. And the word for that is a canon. When you hear somebody talk about canons, and the word canon just means rule. So we had to decide what the canon or the rule would be in all of these motets. Now, modern transcribers write them all out for us and you don't have to think. But anyway, it's kind of a nice little basis. You now have just done a secular motet, okay? Nice going. And I gotta tell you, I was really impressed with your sound, all right? Here is the melody that Palestrina, who was back in the 1500s, the maestro di cappella in the Sistine Chapel. He composed Sicut Cervus for that Sistine Chapel choir, okay? And this is what it sounds like. Sicut cervus desiderat ad fontes aquarum. Do you see how it's kin to the chant, but not exactly? Okay, you ready? Everybody, you ready to sing it with me? Let's sing Sicut cervus together. Ready? And go. Oh, I'm getting some funny looks from people. That's my point. It's not very memorable, is it? It keeps a clean mind. It's not when you hear a Wendy's commercial and sing that melody all day long and it drives you crazy. The power of Renaissance music in healing the mind, okay? By the way, if we were living back in the 1500s, that's what our music would look like. So here's a big part, and I think you'll like that, okay? Now, I've got a treat for you. You're going to visualize now. We've heard Sicut Cervus chant. Now we're going to listen to a motet built on that chant, and you're going to get to visualize it. Let me give you some things to look at. You don't have to read music. Here is a full scale from this blue oval to this blue oval. That is what we would call today an octave. And you can hear and you can see these little white things, that's showing the different parts that are singing. So you'll hear a choir singing, but through color, you'll be able to visualize the texture of this piece. And I hope you enjoy this. I love that I found this. Let me turn the lights down just a little bit so the colors are really vibrant. Do you hear the same melody coming in? There it is again. Thank you. Isn't that absolutely gorgeous? And so gentle, but it speaks so much with this gentleness. That's what I love about it. Okay, I just thought, and I have to turn the lights off again, you might like to add another dimension to your listening experience. I love the visual as well. I found this wonderful recording with this now, though, the 2014 Sistine Chapel Choir, and you see all the little boys singing with this as well when they were allowed to video. But adding another element, I was in the Sistine Chapel this summer, and it's quite, standing there is quite an experience, particularly with this beautiful artwork. I thought that I would give like a 30-second clip so that you could hear it and see it. And by the way, this picture right here, they're not performing from there, but this is the main choir loft that Palestrina would have conducted from at this time there in the chapel. Did you notice that the maestro di cappella was only conducting the beats? He had to train the choir how to sing the natural word stress and everything. So a choir conductor back in those days really didn't do a lot of conducting. They just kept a beat. And because music notation wasn't exact, they had to tell the choir members which note to sing up a half step or down a half step to make the chords dumb. So you were almost like a music theory teacher as a director of the choir, okay? Now, I've got another treat for you I think that you're going to enjoy. The Ave Maria, we're all kind of familiar with that text, as well as the plain song is done by a female group, the women from the cathedral singers here. And then followed by that, you're going to hear the motet that's based on this. So we get to kind of put them side by side. I included something, if you want to follow on in the text, so you can hear the natural metric stress of the text. I've included the accents here so you can kind of see how this choir organizes everything so we have some semblance of shape to the chant.
Thank you.
Did you notice the higher the notes went, the louder it got and the stress marks came at a wonderful time? I've got another piece that I'd like you to hear. This is performed by the King Singers, and may I say, one of my favorite pieces. This is Ave Verum Corpus of William Byrd from England. William Byrd was a very rich man who cornered the market on staffed paper. He had a grip on that, and he was very wealthy. At this time, we'd switch now to the Church of England. Catholicism was on the back burner, but not for William Byrd, because he was so rich, the king granted him favors, so much that he could still compose music in the old Catholic style. Okay, so that's very important to know that. So, he's a long way from Rome, and when you're a long way from Rome, you don't have to follow the rules, because who's going to check up on you, right? So, you'll notice that this piece is very different. Absolutely gorgeous harmonies. A mixture of polyphony and homophony, and these guys, the King Singers, just do a wonderful group. And so they come close to sounding with an all-male group. And so these two guys over here are, they call them countertenors, but in actuality, the term is falsettists. They've developed their falsetto voice that allows them to sing up and emulate the sounds of little boys singing. I apologize for cutting this piece so short, but we had to move on for time because there's so much more beautiful sections of this. I loved the way the text, did you feel the flowing meter changing all the time? They did such a wonderful job on this. Uh-oh, now let's look at Thomas Louis de Victoria, the Omnium Mysterium, the magnificent great mystery, a Christmas motet. What's important about this, O Magnum Mysterium, is the fact that it's built on that. Remember when I talked earlier about intervals and the perfect interval? This one is built, the melody is built on a perfect fifth. And you're going to hear that in the opening round of this. What I love about this, lots of suspensions, lots of resolution, and you'll hear many different textures throughout. So see, even the Spanish could get away with it since they were a long way from Rome. Here we go. By the way, the 16 by Harry Christophers, they specialize in this type of music. Okay, we're about to listen to my favorite piece on the program this evening, the Parce Mihi Domine of Cristobal Morales. We'll keep it in the Spanish vein right now, sung by the Monteverdi Choir, conducted by John Elliott Gardiner. You can read the words along if you'd like to or close your eyes. I find this very, very relaxing. Basically, we have a chant melody that is harmonized by chords along. So everybody's singing the same rhythm brought up by the text. That determines the rhythm. Here we go. Isn't that gorgeous? I got an idea. Let's make it better. How do you do that? I think they found out a way. Remember my slide earlier that said we take something old that makes us feel new? Let's take something old and add something new to it. So I lied to you earlier. This is my favorite thing I have on here. Done by Jan Garbarek, a saxophone player, the Paul Hillier Ensemble, which, by the way, also specialize in this early music. I think you're going to love it. Basically, what we have is the same music you just heard, but we've added a descant part on top with a saxophone, and I'm not saying it's kind of expressive. It is tremendously expressive, and I find it. I still get a tear when I'm at home listening to this. It touches me, and how many years have I listened to this? Here we go. That's so advanced. This was written in the Renaissance, but you music majors know what I'm talking about. Do you hear that deceptive cadence at the end? That was like 21st century, 20th century music being done at the time of the Renaissance. I thought that was absolutely wonderful. One other thing I'd like to point out, did you notice all those bump, bump, bump when the saxophone kept hitting the same note and hold over? That's a technique called medieval hocket. And I think it's brilliant that he put it in with this particular motet. You know, it was very interesting. This album here is filled with pieces just like this. One of my favorites. Hey, let's move over now to Vocis Et. Miserere mei of Gregorio Allegri. He was a priest known for his humility, known for his kindness and goodness, and his music sounds that way. This is a piece that was so famous in its day, and even later, that the young Mozart, as a teenager, went to Vatican City, then went to the Sistine Chapel to hear this piece performed. He was so touched and moved, he went home, and as Mozart would do, wrote the whole thing down from memory. When you hear this, you'll go, wow, that was something. Now, some scholars say that the piece was so famous that Mozart probably heard it before then, but even if he did, from memory, really? Wow, that's something, okay? What you also need to know, and I love this when this happens, this great work of art is based on a mistake. What has made it famous is a mistake. The sopranos sing the main melody in one section, and you'll hear them, they have to jump up and sing softly a high C. Well, that's money-making notes for an opera singer, right? Not many people can sing a high C, but if you're going to perform this, you have to. Here's the great story. The prestigious Groves Dictionary of Music and Musicians, you guys I know have gone to that to look at that in your studies. They transcribed this to include it in their 1880 catalog, and they made a mistake. The transcriber who was writing down the music actually got it mixed up with a piece of, with an arrangement of this done by Felix Mendelssohn. And so they copied most of the original and made a mistake at this one section, which has made it ultimately one of the most famous pieces. Famous in its time and famous today. How do you do that? How do you beat that? I think you'll know why here. And by the way, this is my favorite group to listen to early music on because they sing with adjust tuning. So they're singing absolutely perfect intervals. They're not using tempered tuning like a piano is tuned and the intervals are not exact. But you really hear, and you probably will hear it in the room, the buzz that they create when they put that high format ring on it and you get the partials going as well. Okay? And you'll notice that it's a combination of a motet and also of chant melody. And you'll notice the singers are moving around. They're trying to recreate what would have happened in a cathedral where you had separate choir lofts and you could move around. They're just walking around to make the change. And you'll notice they're using some technology to bring this to light as well. Again, apologies for cutting the recording short, but I wanted to move on. Isn't that a glorious piece? Oh. Now, the last piece we're going to listen to is also a very unusual piece and frankly would work today and we might not notice the difference between what era it was composed. Spem in Alium by Thomas Tallis. Woo, very unusual piece, okay? It's made up of 8 choirs of 5 voices only, so you have 40 separate individual parts. Each choir, soprano, alto, tenor, baritone, and bass, probably sung in the round for listeners. So my normal presentations would be done with my choir, and we would have done this, and we'd have circled the forces here so you could hear what it feels like to be in the middle of all that sound, as I've tried to emulate a little bit with the speakers here today. So it would look something like this, okay? And that was a new concept back then. So the anecdote as it comes, and this is according to Thomas Woodrich, who was a law student, who said that the Duke entertained some Italian composers who were bragging to them about all their multi-voice motets they were now writing. No more 2-voice, 3-voice, 4-voice, but multi-voices. And of course, he called upon Thomas Tallis to take the challenge and write the most glorious motet for 40 voices. And guess what? He did it. And guess what? It's still famous today. So he beat out the Italians. When does that happen in music? That's absolutely wonderful, okay? So this is performed by a special group called Stile Antico. Stile Antico is the word, that's the call word for Renaissance music. Stile Moderno is the term that we'd use for the Baroque period that happened after that, right? So I love their name, okay? And I love, again, old and new come together. They have made this a rather authentic performance with the use of technology, and they weren't even in the same room. Is that cool or what? I love that, okay? So here we go, and I love the title. This is from this project, Talus and Lockdown. We have COVID going on right here. And all of this was done with smartphones and tablets, and obviously the person who mastered this recording really gets the credit for this. Now, let me tell you what I want you to listen for is that, remember I talked about how hard it was to make loud and soft and everything in a cathedral setting? They bring this out beautifully. You see more voices, you hear louder sounds. Because there's 40 voices, they have to have a lot of motion or it'll look kind of boring. But I want you to also, when you listen to this, hear all the voices that are moving around and jumping around from note to note. There's a lot of action on the inside. Just so you know what's going on here, here's one choir and another choir all the way down to the last choir. When they sing, they're illuminated and you can see them and you'll hear the differences in this. Isn't it great though? I still marvel that it took a lot of knowledge for them to take the modern technology and make it sound like a real experience. It's done very well with this recording. Spem in Allium. People into a 40-voice choir. I think that's wonderful. I love that. We're about done here. I have some suggestions. If you ask me, it's all about quality. It's simply about quality to enhance the listening experience and the effect it has on you. Always find a comfortable listening position in a beautiful place from which to listen from. That has a wonderful effect on your experience. Please consider the quality of the recording that you listen to, both the quality of the performers and in this modern day, the mastering of that has a big, big impact on your experience. Quality of listening devices, there's many you can use. My favorite thing to use was a gift from my son, Bose wireless noise-canceling headphones, so I don't have to hear any other sounds. Frankly, I like to listen to movies with these because you hear all the little sounds you don't hear on your TV speakers, but I love this because it cuts me off from interference and I can get lost in my recording and everything. So those are my little things that I think that you really like. Ensembles, who do you go to? If you want a truly wonderful experience, yes, there are some groups that are better than others. I don't want to let you think this is all that's there. These are some of the greats that I think you would like, okay? And then let's go on. I promised everyone in here playlists, and here they are. And by the way, this is all available to you at my website. And when we go to the last slide, you'll see the QR code that'll take you to my website as well. And I have a PDF of this that you can download. The links all work. I checked it out, so you don't have to hunt. But that's the good part. I take you to one link, and then you're going to find 15 other recordings that you're going to equally love. So it really is a lot of fun doing your searching. And for your benefit, you can find Dr. JC's playlist on Spotify. It's called Healing Renaissance. All you need is a free Spotify account, and you can find this. I put everything you heard tonight is on that. Additionally, I put some of my other favorites on there that I think you'll really enjoy. Okay? Let's see. Well, for those of you that may want to develop your favorite Renaissance composer, I've got everyone up here organized by country and date, and you can type that in to Spotify or type that in to whatever you use to listen. YouTube is getting really good now. In fact, I have YouTube Premium, so I don't have to listen to the commercials or anything anymore, and I love that. I probably listen to that more than anything, and here's the composers you would like. Now, this is what I think is magnificent. Okay. Do you know Renee Fleming, who is America's main opera singer? She is our finest soprano here in present day. She has a foundation. What they're going to do in December, Music as Medicine, the Science and Clinical Practice, they are going to present 6 years of research on how music is used as medicine and its effect, and it's a free conference to attend virtually. All you have to do is sign up there. I can't wait to see what they come up with. So we'll be probably looking at a lot of things that are not yet published. So I want to make sure I pick up some of these, some of the information that they provide. Okay? Anyway, it's a pretty good gig when the National Institute of Health, the Endowment for the Arts, and the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts is involved. You know it has worth and it's meaningful, okay? So, we're done. This is the QR code if you want to go to my website and find the PDF of all of those resources. And may I say, I have had a great time tonight. My neighbors are here, my family is here, friends are here, and my former students took the time to come and see their old professor talk a little bit about music. Right over here, we have some wonderful treats, and I want to thank Michelle Palafis for going to all the trouble to prepare this tonight for us. And Michelle, by the way, she's the grand poobah of the Hoffman Estates Arts Commission, along with my brother-in-law, who's a trustee for the village of Hoffman Estates. So if you want to complain about speeding or anything, give him a call, and he'll take care of it. That's an inside joke, okay? please join us for some sustenance and let's visit just a little bit, okay? But before I let you go, do you have any questions? I went over things pretty quickly. I see I've answered everything and you have no questions. My favorite response. Okay, guys, thank you for coming. I really enjoyed it. Thank you.